excited to be in church today. Amen. Let's everybody stand. Psalms 89, I will sing of the Lord's great love forever. With my mouth, I will make your faithfulness known through generations. Let's give Jesus another shout this morning. We're going to see if we can get you moving a little bit.
Praise the Lord.
I give him a shout this morning? Amen. Did you come in here to give Jesus praise this morning? If you did, I'm going to ask you to give him a hand clap because he's worthy, right?
Amen. Praise God. So we all know what time of service it is. Time to give. Amen. Amen. Our offering scripture this morning comes from Exodus. Exodus chapter 25, verse 2. It says, tell the Israelites to bring me an offering, and you will receive the offering from me for everyone who has heart prompts him to give. So many Bible verses show us a long history of giving. In the Old Testament, we see the congregation of the people go giving to build the temple. Giving is also an act of worship. In all cases, the Lord is looking for a giving heart. Amen. From a giving heart, not out of rule or following obligation. Amen. He's looking for a giving heart. Amen. So we're asking you this morning to give with your heart and at the same time have an understanding to build up the kingdom of God. Amen. Amen. If we can all bow our heads, please. Gracious Heavenly Father, we thank you again for this morning. We thank you for the opportunity to be in your house, in your presence, Heavenly Father. We thank you, Heavenly Father, for the ones that are here this morning, and we just ask for a blessing upon each and every one of them. And right now, Heavenly Father, we come to the time of giving, and we just ask again that our hearts, Heavenly Father, be receptive to you, receptive to your word, receptive to your house, receptive to giving, Heavenly Father. Again, with the understanding is to build up your kingdom, to give you glory. We thank you again for all that you do in our lives and that you're going to do, for it's in Jesus Christ's name we pray. Amen.
So your offerings this morning. How many of you are thankful for freedom? You know, the Bible says who the Son sets free is what? All right. Who the Son sets free is what? Free indeed, right? So we've got some freedom in here. So let's worship like we do.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
this morning, I want you to say it.
No more shackles, no more chains, no more bondage, I am free, yeah, we're free. No more shackles, no more chains, no more bondage, I am free, yeah.
Father, you're free.
Hallelujah, 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 freedom, 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 freedom.
Somebody give Jesus a shout. How many of you are thankful for freedom? Amen. You know, the Bible says to come into his presence with thanksgiving. Can we just give him a hand clap of thanksgiving this morning?
Blessed are those who run to him, who place their hope and confidence in Jesus. He won't forsake them. Blessed are those who seek his face, who bend their knee and fix their gaze on Jesus. They won't be shaken. Come on and praise the Lord with me. Sing if you love his name. Come on and lift your
watching. Every chance I get, I'll bless your name. Bless God. when the whip is for me. Bless God when the walls are falling. Bless God for he goes before me. Every chance I get, oh bless your name. Bless God for he holds the victory. Bless God for he's always with me. Bless God for he's always worthy. Every chance I get, oh bless your name. Hey! Every chance I get, oh bless your name. Oh, 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 oh. Every chance I get, oh, and break the give him a shout. Romans 12:1. And so, dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to give your bodies to God because all he has done for you. Let them be a living and holy sacrifice, the kind he will find acceptable. This is truly the way to worship him. To give him our all is the only way to come into his presence and to worship him. Now, one person clapped. So one person gets it. To give him every single thing about us. Can we just lift our hands up this morning? And can you just tell him that you just want to give him every part of you? Lord, be magnified in us this morning. Whatever that looks like, we're yours. We're creation suddenly articulate with a thousand tongues to lift one cry. Then from north to south and east to west, we'd hear Christ be magnified. Yeah.
strong and worship you. And if it puts me in the fire, I'll rejoice because you're there too. I won't be formed by feelings. I'll hold fast to what is true. And if the cross brings transformation, I'll be crucified with you. 'Cause death is just a doorway into resurrection life. And if I join you in your suffering, then I'll join you in your rise. And when you return in glory with all the angels and the saints, my heart will still be singing and my song will be the same. Oh, Christ, let his praise arise. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified from the altar of my life. Christ be magnified in me. Oh, Christ be magnified. Let
worship you. Lord, don't let us ever come in here for any other reason but that.
From their tombs, all the angels stood in awe. souls of all who come to the Father are restored. Then the church of Christ was born. Then the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel and shall not fade. By His blood and in His name, in His freedom I am free. For the Lord who has resurrected me.
Important thing is who you believe that He is. Because if you believe that He's King over your life, then that's who He is. But if you don't believe that, then you're going to believe the lies of the enemy.
We praise You, Lord. We exalt You, Lord. Come on, lift your hands up. Lift your hands up. Stand on your feet. Lift your hands. Hallelujah. We love You, Lord. Come on, praise Him. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Give me a C chord. We praise You, Lord. We exalt You, Lord. Come on, get your mind on the Lord. Just lift your hands and worship Him. Hallelujah. 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 Over and over. Somebody say praise the Lord. I want you to stand up. Everybody stand up. Look over to your neighbor and say praise the Lord. Tap them on the shoulder and say, I'm talking to you. Somebody say praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Somebody say praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Somebody say praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. I'm going to keep saying it till everybody does it. Somebody say praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Somebody say praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Do you know what amazes me? Whenever people go to ball games, they have no trouble hollering and screaming, but when they go to church, it's like trying to pull teeth. Look over to your neighbor and say, praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Isn't it good to be in the house of the Lord today? Amen. Well, I'm glad to be here, even if you're not. I'm thankful for the privilege that God has given me to be able to share the Word of God with you today and those that's watching by internet. Give Jesus another hand clap and you can be seated. Today we're going to be talking about a new topic. I don't know whether it's going to turn into a series or not, but it's good for today. But is that all right? It might even be good for tonight. Look over to your neighbor and say, have you ever thought about God's will? Now, I want you to look at your neighbor again, because some of you must be fighting with one another because you're not talking to each other. But look at each other again and say, have you ever thought about God's will? Answer them back, yes or no. Have you ever literally sat back and thought about God's will? Well, the past couple weeks, I've been thinking about it. I actually started writing this sermon a couple weeks ago, and I stopped and because it was taking me down, as Keith calls, rabbit holes that I'd never been down before, and I wanted to really, really get a grip on it, and I got some grip, but not the grip that I believe God completely wants me to have, because when I got down to it, and I got to looking at it, and I got to thinking about it, I run into where man is a free moral agent. And I begin to think about man being a free moral. Do y'all even know what that means, man being a free moral agent? That means you've got the freedom to do whatever you want to do, however you want to do it. Out of everything that God has created upon this earth, you are the only individual thing. Did you know you're a thing? That you are the only thing that God says, I cannot command my will upon them, and I won't. So Maury and I, we were talking about that a little bit yesterday, and I said, well, if we don't have God, if I say no to God and then I say no to the devil, I'm doing my own thing. And she said, no, you forgot that you're straddling the fence then, and who owns the fence? Who owns the fence? The devil does. So you're doing the devil's will. But yet we have an opportunity to either choose to serve the Lord or to serve the devil. You see, you might think that you're living your own life, doing your own thing, acting your own way, but in all honesty, there's an influencer that is behind you. God desires to influence you. I'm going to say that one more time. God desires to influence you, but not so much influence as he does to just want to be your friend. How many of you remember whenever we were kids, we used to sing that song, What a Friend We Have in Jesus? My dad used to sing that when he attended church. What a friend we have in Jesus. Y'all remember that? And he would just sing that song, and there was times he'd sing and the tears rolled up in his eyes because he spoke about his friendship with Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. But God's will is so huge and so big that it's hard for man to even begin to comprehend it, because whenever we begin to think about God's will, we begin to think that God is trying to control us. That God is trying to make us do what he wants us to do. But friend, that's not like that at all. The only person or the only individual that's ever trying to control you is who? Say that again. Say that one more time. Is anybody even paying attention to me today? I'm the guy with the ugly suit on or jacket on. The devil. God is in control of everything on this earth except you until you allow him to. I'm going to say that one more time. God is in control of everything on this earth except you until you allow him to. You are in control of yes or no. Why? Because you're a free will agent. When God created man and he breathed life into man, he breathed that life into man to say, hey, live your life however you want, but if you make the wrong choices in life, you're going to suffer the consequences of the choices that you make. Can I get an amen? But I love you enough, and I care about you enough. You're my creation to say, do what you want. And we've been doing what we want now since birth. Some of you might say, no, I didn't get to do what I want. My mom and dad made me listen. They cracked the whip whenever I did wrong. But listen, to a point, you still did what you want. Is anybody out there this morning? You are free moral agents. We're free to live and to think and to act according to our own will, not God's will. According to our own will. I want you to hear the word of the Lord. In Joshua 24:15, it says, but if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourself this day whom you're going to serve. Whether the gods of your ancestors served beyond the Euphrates or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you're living. But as for me, here's what Joshua's saying. As for me and my house, I'm going to serve the Lord. You see, you've got an opportunity every day of your life to allow Jesus to be the Lord of your life, but a friend. Every day he's looking for a friend. Can I get an amen? He's looking for somebody to love on, for somebody to care about. Are you listening to me today? For somebody to encourage, to somebody to help, to somebody to lead and guide in the right way. The Bible even says that he loves you so much that he will open the windows of heaven. And why would you not want him to be your friend if he's going to bless you? But people don't. They don't because a lot of the times they feel like that being a Christian or going to church or Jesus being the Lord of your life is control. Well, I can't do this and I can't do that and I can't do. I'm going to ask you something. Whenever you fall in love with somebody, you wouldn't want to do anything that's going to hurt them anyway. Can I get an amen? When you truly fall in love with an individual, you will never, ever set out to do anything that's going to harm them intentionally. Can I get an amen? So the problem that we've got is not so much of a control thing. It's the devil whispering in our ears to keep us from having a love relationship with the Lord. Can I get an amen? He's trying to keep us from being blessed. He's trying to keep us from being anointed. He's trying to keep us from being an influencer of somebody else that will one day be able to make heaven their home. Can I get an amen? Y'all getting this? If you're getting this, hold your hand up right now. John 1:12 says, yet to all who did receive him, listen to this. Yet to all who did receive him, to those that believed in his name, he gave the right to become the children of God. I receive him. I'm a free moral agent. My will is to receive God. God's will is to receive me. So therefore, we're both in His perfect what? Because I received Him. God's will in my life is to make me part of a family. How many of you could use a family in here today? You could use somebody to love on you a little bit. Somebody to be kind to you a little bit. Somebody to help you through the hard times of your life. Somebody to be there with you even in the good times. Somebody to laugh with. Somebody to shout with. A place to belong. Can I get an amen? Well, that's all Jesus is trying to do for you. That's all He's trying to do is to make you part of His family. And the devil, he doesn't want that. He wants you to feel isolated, hated, disgusted, and busted, distracted. He wants you to feel like nobody cares, nobody's concerned. He wants to make you feel like that you are the last man that Jesus would do anything for. But I've come to tell you today that Jesus loves you just the way you are. He accepts you just the way you are. Can I get an amen? He wants you to be part of His family just the way that you are. God's will is to love you in spite of what you think of yourself. In John 6:67, it says you do not want to leave to do. It says you do not want to leave to do you. He's asking the disciples this. It's all about choice. These passages alone give us a clear view that we have freedom to accept or to reject God. You've got the right to obey or to disobey. Here's a thought. So if we are free to act, think, or do whatever we want, it will be easy for us to follow after the flesh, right? Let me say it one more time. If I'm a free moral agent and I'm free to do whatever I want to do, then therefore I live in a fleshly body. It is most likely going to be a lot easier to do whatever my flesh wants to do. Can I get an amen? Why? Because I already live in a fleshly body. So therefore, I've got to be able to change the flesh. I've got to be able to change what I'm living in. And the only way that I can change what I'm living in is I've got to say, Lord, it is my desire to give my will to You. It is my desire to be a part of Your family. How many of you have that desire today? How many of you want to be a part of the family of God? You see, you're surrendering your will. Listen, if you are not part of the family of God, whether you like this or want to accept this or not, you are a part of Satan's family. You say, well, that's not my will. To reject God is to be rejected by God. You see, the thought the devil has given everybody today is that they can live any way they want to live and do anything they want to do and still be able to go to heaven. You cannot go to heaven without being a friend of God's. I mean, that's like just walking in someone's house and sitting saying, hey, I'm here. Well, who are you? You hear somebody holler, dinner time, you're the first one there with the turkey leg. What? Why are you sitting at my table? Why are you eating my food? Who in the world are you? I don't even know who you are. But yet you're sitting here in my house. You think you have a right just to come up in my house and sit down and eat my food? Well, that's exactly what the devil wants you to think whenever you don't want the Lord to be the Lord of your life. When you've not made Him your friend. Whenever you have not allowed your will to be part of His will for your life. And you still think that you're going to be able to make heaven your home. Friend, listen to me. I'm going to tell you something right now. The only way to accept the Lord, the only way to make heaven your home is to accept the Lord. Are you falling asleep on me? I hope I'm not that boring. The only way that you are going to be able to make heaven your home is to accept the Lord Jesus Christ in your life, to ask Him to forgive you of your sins, to say, Lord, be merciful unto me, a sinner, and allow Him to come in and dwell inside of your life. Listen, you have tried so many different things upon this earth. Why don't you give the Lord a try? You've done so many things upon this earth. Why don't you do Jesus for a little bit? Can I get an amen? I promise you that He will bless you more and touch you more and supply for you more and help you more than anything else that you have ever done in this life. Would somebody give Him a hand clap this morning? You see, true freedom only comes through a partnership with Christ. Relationship starts with being willing to submit our ways to God or Satan. I want to look at a place with me this morning. Look at Genesis chapter 3. Let's look at Genesis chapter 3. I want us to look at something. I want you to see how deceptive the devil is. When God created man with a choice. And He used a tree. Now, some of you can call it an apple tree, a pear tree, a grape tree. I don't care what you call it. He put a tree in the middle of a garden to give man a choice of either obey God or disobey. I've heard people say, well, why bother to even put the tree there? Because the Lord is always going to test you to see if you're fit for the kingdom of God. To see if you truly want Him, you truly desire Him, you truly are willing to listen to what He wants to do for you in this life. Look at this, Genesis chapter 1, chapter 3, verse 1. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field, which the Lord God had made, and said unto the woman, yea, hath God said, ye shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, yea, we may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but in the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God had said, ye shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest ye die. Well, every day the devil's whispering that stuff in your ear. Live however you want. Do whatever you want. Act any way you want. It's okay. God understands. No. That's not accurate. Can I get an amen? You want to obey God. Listen as He continues to whisper. How many's ever had the devil to whisper stuff in your ear to try to encourage you or discourage you or pull you away from where the Lord would have you to be? Anybody ever had that happen to you? Come on, wave at me. It said, and the serpent said unto the woman, ye shall not surely die. Listen to the lies. For God doth know that in the day that ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. How many of you know the difference between right and wrong? For God doth know that the day ye eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as God, knowing good and evil. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that was pleasant to the eyes, and the tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof, and did eat, and gave unto her husband with her, and he did eat. And guess what happened? Their eyes was opened. For the first time, in Adam and Eve's life, they felt what's called separation because of disobedience. You see, you need to understand something this morning. It is God's will not to separate you. It is God's will to walk with you, to talk with you. Listen, when you study the story of Adam and Eve, God literally come down from heaven and sat down and talked to Adam in the cool of the day and talked to him about the things he had done. Can you imagine God Himself coming down out of heaven right now and sitting down beside of you and saying, hey, how's your day been? What's going on in your life? Can we share with one another? How imaginable that would be. They had all of these things, but that they give it up. Because of a lie. Here we are sitting in this church today. The Lord is willingly setting out His hand, saying, come unto me, all ye that are laboring and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. And we're constantly saying no. You see, a lot of people serve God for what He can do for them. A lot of people, they even go to church for the social hour. The pastor don't preach anything that's too hard because he don't want to run the crowd that he's got off. So he'll preach something that's easy to keep them there, but not this preacher. Might be why our attendance is not always the best. We want the truth of the word. Can I get an amen? We want God to tell us the truth. So therefore he says, if you obey me, if you'll listen to me, if you'll allow me to be a part of your life, he said, I will bless you coming in and bless you going out. Can I get an amen? Look over to your neighbor and say, Jesus loves you. Why would you not want to allow someone that loves you to be a part of your life? The Bible says in Jeremiah 29:11, for I know the plans that I have for you, saith the Lord. Plans for welfare and not for evil, to give you a future and of a hope. In Psalms 143, verse 10, David was saying, teach me to do your will. I want everybody to do something right now. Stand up if you're able to. Teach me to do your will. Hear that again. Teach me to do your will. That tells me something. That tells me I don't know what all God's plan is for my life. I've got to seek it out. I've got to desire it with everything that is inside of me. David said, teach me, Lord. I love you enough and I'm willing enough, Lord, to say, here I am. Teach me to do your will. I don't want to be out of your will, because I know that if I'm out of your will, I'll be like Adam and Eve and I will listen to the serpent and I will eat something I shouldn't eat, do something I shouldn't do, be involved in something that I shouldn't be involved in. And all of these cursings, all of these things, listen, they were cast out of the garden because of disobedience. How many times do we miss out on the blessings of the Lord simply because we chose not to do the will of God? In Romans 12:2, it says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern that the will of God is, what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. So I want you to close your eyes just for a moment. And I want you to say, Lord, help me to do your will. Will you be the Lord of my life? Come on, say, will you be the Lord of my life? Please come into my heart. Help me this day to do your will. Not my will, but yours be done. Hear this, you can be seated. Your will is always fleshly will, unless it is covered or seasoned through the Word of God. Can I get an amen? God's will is to bless you coming in and bless you going out. Deuteronomy 28:1-14 says that. When we don't pray for God's will, we won't act on his will and we won't obey his will. Can I get an amen? Number four, pray for God's will to be done in your life. In Matthew 6:10, it says, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. In Proverbs 3:5-6, it says, trust in the Lord with all of your heart and lean not into your own understanding, but in all of your ways acknowledge him, and he will direct your path. Pastor Curley, what is God's will for my life? Look up here. He's looking for a friend. He's looking for a relationship. He's looking for somebody that wants to be blessed. This is not a book of rules. This is a book of blessings. This is not a book of you better do. This is a book of I want to do. This book shall not depart from my mouth, but I shall meditate upon it day and night. This word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. I will take this word and I will hide it inside of my heart that I might not sin against God. I do these things simply because I desire to do God's will. God's will is not to force you into friendship. God's will is not to force you into a relationship. God's will is to love you. To love you, to care about you, to help you. So in closing this morning, I ask you, what is keeping you from accepting God's will in your life? The answer is your free moral agency. You just don't want to. This morning, as you stand to your feet again, and I promise I'll not make you sit back down anymore. Stand if you can. If you can't, stay seated. What is your excuse for not giving your heart to Jesus? What is your excuse? There is so much distraction in here today. It's been really hard to preach. Look up here, listen. What is your excuse for not serving the Lord? I can tell you through all the years that I've been a preacher, I've heard about every excuse known to man of why people tell God no. Kids will say, well, I'm too young. I want to party. I want to live. Too many rules. Others will say, well, I've been hurt in church. How many's been hurt in church before? Hold your hand up. If I could hold my hands and feet up, they'd all go up. Well, Pastor Curley, I prayed for things to work out and it just didn't work out. I think God just does not even care anything about me. Does that sound like God or does that sound like the devil? That sounds like an excuse. Can you get an amen? You see, we need the Lord in our life. We need Him in our life, and we need Him today in our life. This morning, with your head bowed, your eyes closed, nobody moving around, nobody talking, I ask, is there one in this place that would raise their hand right now and say, Pastor, pray for me, I'm lost. I need Jesus. I need Jesus. Is there one? I see your hand. I see your hand. Is there somebody else that's willing to say, I'm willing to give up my will and give Jesus a try today? I'm willing to surrender all. Somebody right. There's people here today that know the truth You know what the Bible says, but you're straddling the fence. You don't want to give completely into the Lord. You're hurt. You're aggravated. Things are not going the way that you planned. That's part of why you've not surrendered all. Well, let me share something with you. God's not going to leave you alone because you've already had a taste of His goodness. He's not going to walk away from you because you've already been a part of the family. It's you that's keeping the blessings from coming because you're walking in the flesh and you're fulfilling the lusts of the flesh. How about it? Is there another this morning that would raise their hand and say with their hand, Pastor, pray for me. I need Jesus. I see your hand. I see your hand. I tell you what we're going to do. I want everybody in this place to come and stand up front. Everyone in this place, come stand up front right now. We're going to make this easy today. I want you to join hands right now, everyone in this place. Stretch out. Stretch out and join hands with the person you're beside of. I want you to bow your head. I want you to close your eyes. And I want everyone in this place, from the bottom of your heart, to say the sinner's prayer with me. Listen to me. You're making a choice as a free moral agent. The more I'm going to get into that, even deeper, because it just keeps blowing in my mind. As a free moral agent, you're desiring today to do the will of God, and that is to start a relationship with Him by saying, Dear Heavenly Father, forgive me of my sins. Come into my heart. Save my soul. Help me from this moment on to serve you in Jesus' name. Amen. Now look up here. Get a Bible that you can read and understand. Years ago, the Pentecostal church said King James only. They didn't realize the King James was a translation also. Go get the Living Bible, something that you can read and understand, and study that thing like crazy. Because the things that's in this is going to set your life free and going to help you to one day make heaven your home. How many of you want to go to heaven? Hold your hand up. Do you want to go to heaven? Listen, don't allow the temporary things like a fruit on a tree to keep you from making heaven your home. They were literally cast out. Every time you sin and you do something that you ought not to do that you know that's wrong, you're literally casting yourself away from the presence of the Lord. There's an old song we used to sing in the church, Pass me not, O gentle Savior, hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by. Savior, Savior, hear my humble cry. While on others thou art calling, do not pass me by. Somebody give Jesus a hand. Daisy, put your hand on your daddy's back. So glad to see them today. You don't have to stand up. Just leave him sit there and rest. He has been suffering so much in his back. We've been praying for him. But today I'd like for us to have corporate prayer. him, that God would touch his body in the name of Jesus. Father, as I come to you, Lord, I thank you for my friend. Lord, I thank you they was able to travel here today, Father God, to be in church with us. Lord, I pray, God, that you would touch his body right now in the name of Jesus. We bind the sickness in his body. We rebuke it by the authority of Jesus Christ. I pray for Daisy's mommy. Lord, that you would touch her today as well. That God, you'd lift them up and encourage them. Keep your hand upon them, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Give Jesus a big hand clap. Hallelujah. I want you to join hands one more time. I got a phone call yesterday. I don't know how much I can go into this, but one of our friends here that is a part of our church been diagnosed with stage 4 cancer. It's now went into her brain. They called hospice in. They've only given her a short time to live. She said something to me yesterday that I will never forget the rest of my life. It has caused me to even look at death totally different. The Bible says it's once appointed unto man to die. And then after that, the judgment. So that means every one of us in this room has got to die one day. There's nothing that we can do about it. There's no stopping it. There's no telling God no. When God says it's time, we're going to die. Can I get an amen? And she said, Pastor Curley, she said, I know that it's appointed unto me to die. She said, cancer is just part of it. She said, I'm not upset because I've got cancer. She said, it's just my time to go. As much as I hated to hear her say that, I said, you know what? You've got the right attitude when it comes to drawing your last breath here on this earth. Is that it's your time. Listen, we can be angry and we can be upset. I tell you, a lot of folks get mad at God whenever the Lord takes our loved ones home. When my mama died, it was hard. Still hard. Still struggle with it. But it was her time. And I've never been angry at God. Not one time. But a lot of people, they get angry. They get mad. Because they think that they have a right to tell God when it's time for somebody to pass. We have no right. We just need to be thankful for the time that we had. One of the little girls that went to church here for a little while, her little baby died just the other day. It was only 4 months old. Wayne and I was in Walmart the other day, and the granddad and she was there, and the husband, they were all just loving on that baby and so proud. They were showing that baby off to everybody. You might say, well, how is it God's will for a baby to live 4 months and then die? Because it was his time. It was a blessing for 4 months to a little girl that needed a blessing, that needed to feel unconditional love, because there is no greater love than a little baby or a little child can give to a parent. Y'all know what I'm talking about? There's no greater pride than your own kid. And she got to experience that for 4 short months. You pray for her today. Amen. Give Jesus a big hand clap. Lord, I pray for Anita today. God, that you would touch her. That you keep your hand upon her, Father God. Lord, I thank you for our friendship all these years. I thank you, Lord, for the faithfulness, Lord, she's had with you. And I thank you that she knows you today. And Lord, that she's made you the Lord of her life, that you are her friend. And I pray, God, that you would just lift her up in Jesus' mighty name. Father, I pray for the Howe family today. God, your hand would be upon them, Lord, as they go through this death. That you would comfort them right now and lift them up, Father. There are always going to be questions, Father God, that goes through our mind when death comes. But God, we are trusting in you today to know that you are in control. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen. Would the praise team come? Give Jesus a big old hand clap. Hallelujah.
I sometimes don't ever know what song is going to be next when we hit play on that. And then I just think maybe it's God. You know? I don't know. Can we just stand and just finish out the service in this? Is that okay? Because I can't think of a more beautiful name than His name. Compares to this, what a beautiful name it is. Jesus, you brought heaven down. Your sin was great, your love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is.
Yours is the kingdom, and yours.